Hi, hello, how are you? Welcome to Chapman World.
To understand why binary is important in computing, we need to understand a little of the electronics behind what our computers are doing. So I'm going to give you a brief walkthrough of some of the fundamental principles of the electronics involved inside your computer, and importantly, inside of your CPU. All modern computers are made possible because of a single electrical component called a transistor. The transistor has allowed us to develop a technology in electronics known as T.T.L, or Transistor-Transistor Logic. There are several variants of this technology, and modern computers use a more recent variant, and so they're not really considered to be T.T.L devices any longer. Just as with our CPU model from the previous part, I'm going to be brushing over a lot of the detail here in the interest of brevity. However, the fundamental concepts of T.T.L still apply for modern computers. So we're going to think of our modern CPU as a T.T.L device here for the sake of the intuition that that brings. And again, I welcome you to explore the intricacies later if it suits you to do so. Let's get started then, looking at this electrical component called a transistor. Just as with all electronic components, there are a large range of transistors available, but perhaps the most well-known from a packaging perspective looks like this. This is a little piece of plastic which has three wires protruding from it, and it contains a tiny piece of silicon that has been chemically modified to be our transistor, or to behave in the way a transistor should behave. The CPU and memory devices inside a computer similarly contain silicon, usually with millions or billions of these transistors on them. If you were designing a circuit with a transistor in it, you'd draw a schematic diagram containing a symbol like this one, or something very similar to this symbol. The symbol here shows three connections to reflect the three wires on the physical transistor. Labeled from left to right, we have the collector, the base, and the emitter. Now, the transistor behaves as a kind of switch, but unlike the kinds of switches you may be used to, such as light switches or keys on a keyboard, the transistor is not operated mechanically by pressing it with a finger. Instead, a transistor is turned on or off electronically. Initially, when the transistor is turned off, current is applied to the collector, but it cannot flow through to the emitter, and this is because there is no current at the base. If we apply current at the base, this turns the transistor switch on, and current is then able to flow from the collector to the emitter. This simple on-off behavior is a very limited view of the properties of a transistor, but it's sufficient to reflect what we need to understand for now. The two states of the transistor switch, being on or off, are represented in software as ones and zeros, where one reflects the on state and zero reflects the off state. Ones and zeros being the basic digits of the binary numbering system, this explains why we use binary in software. Essentially, every wire inside of a digital electronic circuit, such as the computer's main logic board, either has current flowing through it or it does not, and we map these two states to ones and zeros, giving rise ultimately to the binary numbering system. In our model of a computer from the previous part, the computer was divided into two major components. We had a memory component to store information, and the CPU component, which was driven by a clock, to perform logic, including arithmetic, on that information. Each of these behaviors is constructed on an electronic level using transistor-based circuits. So now we'll take a look at how some of this logic is performed in the circuitry. All of the instructions that a CPU is able to perform are built up from simple circuits known as logic gates. Logic gates are building blocks from which more sophisticated circuits can be built. There are several of these such logic gates, but today we're going to look at just three of them, and they're named the AND gate, the OR gate, and the NOT gate. The AND gate is by far the simplest of the gates, and its circuit looks like this. Now, at this point, you might be thinking, hey, that's just a transistor, what are you trying to pull? And if you were thinking that, good for you, because you're right. The transistor behaves as a logical AND operation because the emitter only has current if both the collector and the base have current. To restate that another way, if we consider the collector and the base as inputs A and B respectively, and the emitter as output, then we can say that the output will be 1 only when both inputs A and B are 1. In other words, if A or B have current, then the output will have current. If either A or B is 0, then the output will also be 0. This table, also known as a truth table, describes the behavior of an AND gate in binary terms. All combinations of inputs that are on or off are presented in the left two columns, and the output for each combination appears in the right column. Now, as you'll note, the only combination for which the output is 1 is when both inputs are 1. Now let's take a look at another logic gate, in this case the OR gate. This circuit represents the OR gate using two transistors. Now there are two important things to note about this circuit. First is that the collector for both transistors is connected directly to current, meaning they're always on. And the second is that the emitter for both transistors are connected to each other and to the output. If we apply current to the base of the transistor on the left, labeled as input A, then current is able to flow from the collector of that transistor to its emitter and ultimately will power the output. Similarly, if we apply power to the base of the transistor on the right instead, then power would flow from its collector to its emitter and power on the output. Essentially, if we set either input A or input B to 1, then the output will be 1. Here's the truth table for the OR circuit. The astute among you may have noticed something about this OR gate. If both inputs are 1, then so too is the output. And that's okay, this is how an OR gate functions, and it stands true that when both inputs are powered on, the statement if input A or input B still evaluates to true. There is, however, another logic gate which behaves in the same way as an OR operation, but does not accept the scenario of both inputs being on. It's called an exclusive OR or XOR gate, and it'll only output a 1 if exclusively input A or input B is set to 1. Now, the third type of gate that I'd like to look at today is called the NOT gate, or sometimes it's referred to as an inverter. But in this case, I'm not going to draw the circuit for it. You see, the circuit is not particularly complex, but it does involve a couple of additional components. It has one transistor and a couple of resistors. And understanding how it works would involve a deeper understanding of the electronics, the physics behind the electronics. And some of that knowledge in a brief video session like this could even appear contradictory to some of the stuff that we've learned already. So I want to avoid any confusion. We're not going to gain anything from seeing the circuit. Instead, I'm going to use a kind of shorthand that's available for circuit designers when working with logic gates. So there are three symbols here. We've got the AND gate, the OR gate, and the NOT gate. Now we already know what AND and OR do. The NOT gate is very simple. Basically, if the input is a 0, then the output will be a 1. And if the input is a 1, then the output will be a 0. And I've included the truth table for that as well, although by now it should need no further explanation. And so with these three gates, the AND gate, the OR gate, and the NOT gate, we have enough to start building some simple logic circuits. And so now I'd like to take a brief look at how a memory circuit functions, and it's based again on these logic gates. So if we take a look at this circuit, this is an AND gate. What's interesting about this circuit is that the A input, the first input, is wired, hardwired to power, so it's always going to be a 1, and the output is wired back to input B. So in its default state, with input B turned off, the AND gate is not fulfilled, right? So the input on input A is 1, but there's no input on B, so there's no output. And so at output, we have a 0. If, however, we apply current to input B, this turns on the output. And because the output is fed back into input B, we can then remove the current from input B and it will remain on. Essentially, the output is feeding input B back into itself in this feedback loop. And so what you get is a gate that remembers that at some point in the past, current was applied to input B. And this is the basis for computer memory. Obviously, modern computer circuits are a little more sophisticated, but this is essentially the fundamental principle behind how a computer memory functions. What you might notice from the circuit, however, is that there's no way to turn the output back off. Because input A is hardwired to power and input B has been activated and is feeding itself, there's no way to turn this output off and reset it back to a 0. So we're going to enhance the circuit a little here. We're going to throw another AND gate in. This time the AND gate's going in between the output of the first AND gate and the input B of the first AND gate. And then we apply a NOT gate on the other pin of the AND gate. Now I'm going to label the input for the NOT gate as the reset wire or reset pin. So effectively, at the moment, that reset pin has no current. Because it has no current, it's set at a 0, the NOT gate converts that into a 1. So there is current on the input to the AND gate. So again, if we turn our memory on by applying power at input B, this powers up the output pin, which feeds back and activates the second AND gate, And therefore, our first AND gate is powered and it remains on, so it's remembering that we had current at input B. We can now do away with that current, but if we apply input on the reset, well, what happens is the NOT gate converts that 1 into a 0. So our second AND gate is no longer a true scenario, it powers down. And this turns back off the first AND gate, and therefore the output goes off. So this simple circuit gives us a memory that we're able to wire up in such a way that it will remember that it was turned on or that it was turned off. Now I'm going to refer to this circuit as a bit, because essentially the output represents a single binary digit, so one bit of binary. Typically in a computer memory, these bit circuits would be arranged in arrays of 8 or 16 or 32, some power of 2 number of bits. And generally, each of those arrays would have a single reset pin, which connects to all of the bits. So you can reset, let's say we have 8 bits, which is a byte. You could reset the entire byte with just one reset pin. And you could individually set each of the input pins from a data bus, as we discussed in the previous part. And so essentially, that's how memory functions inside of a computer.
Like, subscribe, and hit the bell. We'll be right back.